Okay, let's start. Like I said, Monday, Friday classes are generally a review of what we did in the previous class. Except today we have some new stuff we must talk about because we could not finish it all last class. Next, on Monday, we are going to start section 3. With that being said, your homework is now due next Friday, all the definitions for chapter 2. You understanding how this works now, making sense? The end of each chapter, you have a week to turn in the definitions. So the chapter 1 definitions should be filtering in right now, today. And since I am so nice, if you for some odd reason didn't do this, I will give you until Monday to turn it in. For chapter 1. But if chapter 1 isn't turned in by Monday, that's the end. The gates of mercy close on Monday. Please. Monday if you didn't turn it in. But I'm not going to do that every chapter 2. Alright? Last class, what did we talk about? We spoke about a few different sociological research methods and approaches. But today I'd like to cover a few more. But first, I think we should briefly review... What? Okay. So, chapter 2, finishing up on these methods. So let's first review what we talked about briefly last time for just a few minutes. So on Monday we talked about four main points: validity versus reliability, independent versus dependent variables, probability versus non-probability sampling, and finally the Hawthorne effect, right? So, who wants to try to address one of these? Who can explain one of these four? Pick whatever one you want. Yes, very good.
Well, the validity is how likely research results are computed to be if the study is repeated.
Yes, that is reliability.
Validity, how well the study measures what it was designed to measure.
Exactly. So the example we gave last class about an invalid testing example would be if we're trying to understand the attitudes 18 to 30 year olds about the new election, the new president, the new presidents of this country, and you chose to interview people age 50 to 60. That would be an invalid experiment, right? Because you are not going to get an answer to the question for what 18 to 30 year olds think by interviewing people outside that sample population, correct? Reliability is the reproducibility of the test. So in scientific studies, and especially medical studies, the goal is to get a replication, right? You want your study to show the same results over and over and over. And in medical studies, they run thousands of experiments, right? So if I asked a question on the exam, it was something like, if Pfizer, the big medical company in the United States, ran a clinical trial on a pill to see if it would stop cancer, and it worked 7,000 out of 7,025 times, we would call that a very reliable pill, right? The test showed a reliable result. However, if the test showed that cancer was stopped only 5 times out of 7,000 from taking the pill, that is not reliable, right? So we want to make sure the results are reproduced. So if you get one thing, one test, one thing the next, then one thing the next, then one thing the next, that is an unreliable measure, right? The goal is reliability and validity. So, who wants to try the second one? What about dependent versus independent variables? Let's see all those hands. Yes, in the back, very good.
Independent variables are being changed in order, no, independent variables stay the same, and dependent variables are changed to see the effect.
Actually, it's the opposite. The independent variables... Right, the independent variables cause the change, right? And the dependent variable is the thing being changed. So we gave the ice cream example, right? So if you want to see the sales of ice cream would be the dependent variable, and the independent variables we talked about were the price of the ice cream, the temperature outside, correct? And we actually talked about how actual companies do use these numbers to calculate what would maximize their output in sales. Right? Remember we talked about how the Dairy Queen in the United States is closed during the winter because they finally did the numbers and calculated that yes, they are actually losing money, they're not making as much as they should. It's just not worth it, basically, to have the store open from the months of November to February, because they found a correlation between colder temperatures and less people wanting ice cream, right? So they lowered prices even in the United States during the winter, so people still didn't come. Meaning that that variable, we have two variables, right, had more explanatory power than the other one. So indeed, weather is actually, in some cases, more important than price. They let, you know, they dropped the price of the ice cream cone a couple cents. People still didn't come, it was too cold. Right? So of course they could have dropped it to 5 cents, right? But what would the problem with that be for Dairy Queen? They wouldn't make any money, right? Because the overhead wouldn't even be caught up to the sales. So the idea in business, you want to find that maximum profit maximizing number, right? Okay, probability versus non-probability sample, yes?
Probability sample is when everyone has an equal chance to be picked, chosen, to be in the...
Right. Right, exactly.
Yeah. And non-probability is when you select a group in the population which has a bigger chance than the other group.
Right. So a probability sample means that your sample is completely random, and that every single person in the population has a chance of being picked. So a probability sample of this class would mean I put everybody's name in this hat, and then I draw out, and oh, you're picked. And you can run certain statistical measures and techniques to figure that out. Right? There's more quantitative methods that can be used for probability samples. A non-probability sample means certain members of a population are automatically excluded, meaning they have zero chance of being picked. So the example I gave would be if I put all the names in the hat and drew a name, but all the girls, I said, nope, oh yes, you, good, one. You, two, right? That would be a non-probability example, because every female in that example had zero chance of being picked. And when you use non-probability sampling, you cannot run certain statistical measures to analyze your data. However, non-probability sampling does have its uses. Specifically, when you're looking at specific elements within a larger population. So if I want to look at females and their attitudes towards, females in my class and their attitudes towards the new presidential elections, it would not be very helpful to also interview males, right? So in some cases, we see non-probability sampling being useful. But generally, I think most sociologists and social scientists prefer to use the probability sampling method. Right? And finally, the Hawthorne effect. Somebody knew. Yes?
It's a fact where people change their opinion if they know they are included in some.
Right. The Hawthorne effect is when people purposely change their behavior and their attitudes and their comments to a researcher with the hope that they're saying the things that the researcher wants to hear. And we gave, and this example I gave last class was, what if I asked people's attitudes about Serbians and who lived in Bosnia, right? Well, the Hawthorne effect would say that people, especially for controversial topics, so if I asked a question, let's go back. If I asked the question, what is your favorite M&M color? The Hawthorne effect probably wouldn't be a problem because it's not a very controversial thing, right? Because all M&Ms taste the same regardless of the color, you should know that. And that, you said red, you said blue, you said whatever, it wouldn't matter, right? There is no answer I'm expecting. So non-controversial things generally aren't a problem. But when it gets to controversial things like attitudes about religion and cultures, sometimes people say things that they think the researcher wants to hear. However, it's important to note that this could go two ways, right? The example I gave, attitudes towards Serbians. So I could ask you, and perhaps you're a Bosnian, and you think I'm very patriotic, right? So you assume that I want to hear the patriotic answer, which is, oh, well, you know, we don't like them, we're Bosnians, we're better than them. So that's one example of the Hawthorne effect, right? Where you are answering that you don't like Serbians because you assume I want to hear that, right? The counterexample is what if you assume, so I ask you, and in your mind you think, oh my goodness, well, if I say I don't like them, then I'll come off as, you know, backwards and xenophobic. So I'm going to say I like them. Because you're assuming that I want to hear the socially progressive answer, right? So here we see the Hawthorne effect in two different ways. You saying one thing and you saying the other, both trying to please me, right? So this is a problem we see in sociological research, is that often people will give answers that they think are socially acceptable or the answers that their interviewer wants to hear, right? So when you're doing an interview, yes?
That's why certain scientists use deception.
Right, that's why we try to hide certain elements of our test. But we also have to be very careful how we do the interview, right? So for example, if I'm going to ask this question about Serbian attitudes, and I come to the interview wearing a Serbia hat, a Serbian national soccer and football team jersey, and a big wristwatch to Serbia on it, that's going to probably have a deep impact on what you say. You're probably going to say things that are going to be pro-Serbian without trying not to offend me. So you have to be very careful. These are things that the researcher has to consider. And believe it or not, the way you dress is very important in terms of gathering research. They have actually found that when females that are dressed, you know, sort of in short dresses and try to look like they would go into a club, the people often give different answers. They don't take them seriously sometimes. They say things that they normally wouldn't. So you really need, it's very difficult to find what is defined. You know, you want to avoid any type of bias in your response. So you really got to think about this as a researcher, right? Okay, so we're going to finish up with methods right now, because the last class we didn't get to finish all of them, all right? So the first method in today's discussion will be that of the unstructured interview, right? What is an unstructured interview? Well, simply put, it is an interview in which questions are not prearranged by the researcher, allowing for spontaneity to develop during the interview. All right? Very important. And I give the example of the first date, right? Generally, when one goes on a first date with a boy or a girl, you have some ideas, general idea of what you want to talk about and what you don't want to talk about, right? But usually, the date starts, you say, hey, how you doing? And then the girl or guy says, oh, I'm doing great. And then usually the girl who will start talking about herself. And then the guy then is. And then the guy will then respond based on her questions. And it could go anywhere, right? You could talk about your parents, you could talk about your futures, you could talk about past boyfriends, girlfriends, you could talk about how you were married once, you're divorced, you hate your ex-husband, whatever. It could go in any direction, right? And this is generally what happens. And the good thing about the unstructured interview is that it allows for the interviewer to possibly learn information they never would have thought about asking, right? So yes, it is true. When you let somebody talk about themselves a lot, they generally will tell you things you didn't even expect to hear. So if I only ask them certain questions and didn't give you a chance to tell me, oh, by the way, I'm the top ping pong player in Bosnia, who I met last night, pretty good, I would have never known that, right? So the idea is that you really need to, in an unstructured interview, be prepared for just about anything, and you can learn information you never even thought about asking, right? And it's also important, this is also a strength, one strength to this method is it does build trust and rapport between the researcher and the interviewee, right? So indeed, on a first date, when you let the other person talk a lot without asking them question after question after questions, and then when they say something like, oh, well, you know, my mother, she's very, you know, no, I don't want to hear about your mom. So tell me about your bank account. And then you talk about that, and you get off topic, and then the guy says, no, I don't care about your grandma. Tell me more about what kind of car you drive. See, when you start forcing someone to answer question after question, it becomes more like a medical interview rather than a date. So you lose trust in that. You know, you don't feel as comfortable talking about it when someone's forcing you to answer, right? So indeed, to build the rapport and trust, you need to allow for some spontaneity. So let the person talk, right? However, there are some weaknesses of an unstructured interview because, indeed, you must remember doing social science, not dating. So indeed, this is very difficult to do with large samples where time and constraints are often very relevant, correct? Because if I want to interview four people in an unstructured interview and we do 20-minute interviews each, that'll take about an hour and a half, right? Doable, whatever. If I want to interview 800 people and do a 20-minute interview with each person, that is going to take an awfully long time. And I'm going to have a ton of information I have to sort through, and most of it is probably going to be not useful. Because often people will ramble on about things not useful to the topic. So if I say, tell me your attitude about the Bosnian elections, you might start off by saying, well, you know, I think that the right party won, and I'm very excited. And, you know, my parents voted to, you know, oh, my dad, oh my goodness, the car didn't work that day, he was in such a bad mood. You know, we had to get our gas changed, we had to get an oil changed. It cost like 60K, I was so bad. See, this is information I don't need at all. I really don't need it. But you're giving it to me anyway, so the unstructured interview, the potentiality of you just sort of rambling on and going off topic, is a serious problem. So, you know, but the idea is that in an unstructured interview, you don't really want to interrupt very much, because the idea is you sort of let the person talk. So indeed, you potentially could get 20 minutes worth of completely useless information. So, you know, you try to cue them to get back to the topic if they're going way off, but you don't want to turn it into a structured interview. So that's a fine line. And finally, sometimes important points you would like to address totally get forgotten. So if I ask you about the presidential election, I have 5 questions in my mind that I want to ask, and you spend 18 minutes talking about one, and then there's 2 minutes left, you can't answer all the questions I wanted to sort of get at. So indeed, sometimes you don't even, the person will talk, you don't even get to address the thing you want. So strength would be the spontaneity and the building of trust. And when you build trust, you're more likely to get truthful answers. But the weaknesses would simply be the time constraints, the lack of topicality, and oftentimes you forget to get information you actually need, right? So the semi-structured interview is slightly more, actually a lot more common in the social sciences. The researcher follows a general framework seeking to keep on to the main topic and will generally interrupt. So if you get off topic, this is where I would say, okay, let's get back to the election. That's nice about your car, sorry to hear that, but let's move on. Right? So this is where the interviewee will sort of guide you back to the trap, right? Guide you back to the trap. Generally, the topics and themes discussed are thought about well in advance. So, in a semi-structured interview, I will have about 4 or 5 serious questions that I want you to address at some point. I will make sure I find a way to answer that. So, if we're on minute 16 of the interview and I'm on question 4, then this is where I say, okay, well, let's move on to the next question, right? So, you try to get all your questions answered. The example I give is, think of it like this. What happens when a parent questions you because you want to marry their little princess daughter, right? So this is a very good example of a semi-structured interview. Usually the father, at least from my experience, will sit down with you and they'll try to make you feel comfortable. Have some coffee, have some tea, and they'll ask you some questions. But the questions, they definitely ask what they want to ask. They'll ask you, so Joe, how much is the dollar going to be? You make up a number that's not true, and you talk about how you're going to come up with that money, and then you ramble on, and then they say, okay, that's fine. So next question, Joe, have you ever committed shirk? And then you talk about, no, never. And then I said, Joe, what about Zima? Have you committed Zima? No. What about alcohol? Have you ever drank alcohol? No. And then finally they ask, do you have a job? And then it's like, no, I don't. But the point is that the father or the mother will get those 5 questions out, right? And you can see this is sort of not as comfortable, isn't it? Correct? Because some of these questions are quite personal. And oftentimes, in a semi-structured interview, you want detailed answers. Maybe not as personal as if you ever drank alcohol or committed Zeno, but at the same time, you know, sometimes people feel uncomfortable when they're being directly questioned. They feel like they're being, you know, accused of doing something. So the strength of the semi-structured interview is that often you will get answers to the questions you ask. Because you have prepared in advance questions, you ask them, and you get what you want to hear. And often you will save time on off-topic rambling, right? So by asking the question and drawing the interviewee back to the topic, you will be able to avoid 12 minutes worth of a discussion about somebody's parents and their dinner for the night, right? Or whatever topic's not good. And finally, in a semi-structured interview, you can often gather lots of information in a relatively short amount of time, correct? So you can learn a lot about a person in a 10 to 20 minute interview if you ask the right question and they answer properly. 2 very different things. All right? What are the weaknesses? Well, as we discussed, sometimes the interview doesn't feel as comfortable and this can lead to an awkward interview. Awkward interviews lead to false answers. All right? When you're around somebody you don't really like and answer personal questions, it's easy just to lie or to not give the 100% truth, right? So, a semi-structured interview, you're slightly more likely to not really get the truth. Secondly, sometimes the formalness of the interview itself limits the spontaneity and any possible unexpected useful insights, right? So indeed, by letting a person talk freely, sometimes they'll bring up a point or mention something you didn't even think about asking. It's quite useful. Here's a great example. When I was reading your essays about yourselves, I actually learned a lot about you guys. I didn't know so many of you had family members who were actually killed in the war in Bosnia. It really opened my eyes. I didn't have any idea. At least 7 or 8 people have a direct relative, some whose parents, mother or father, were killed. And it actually sort of made me want to do more research on this region. It made me feel a more personal connection. So indeed, by letting you guys talk about whatever you wanted, it helped me as a social scientist sort of craft my own research agenda. So that was sort of, I feel like the example in the assignment was sort of an example of an unstructured interview. I basically let you talk about yourself. That was the assignment, pretty much. With a couple minor points to talk about. So sometimes the formalness of these semi-structured interviews will limit this. So if I ask 5 questions, you're going to answer 5 questions, and that's pretty much it, right? And finally, there still exists a possibility for going off topic. So in a semi-structured interview, you still have room for talking a little bit about stuff that was not related, et cetera, et cetera. So you're less likely to get as much unnecessary information, but you still might have a few minutes worth of tape you can delete, so to speak. Right? So let's finally talk about the third kind of interview here. It's the structured interview, the formally structured, fully structured interview. The aim of this type of interview is to ask the same questions in the same order to every people, to each person, I mean, right? So this basically ensures both reliability between sample subgroups and different survey periods, right? So think of the customs interview at the airport, right? When we go to customs, we are all pretty much ask the same 5 questions as soon as we get off the plane. You get on to that and talk to that guy with the gun, right? He'll generally say, show me your passport. He'll look at it. And then he'll say, where are you from? Making sure you say the same place as it's on the passport. And he'll ask you what you're carrying in your baggage, how long are you gonna be here, do you have a hotel you're staying in, like when people come to the country with nowhere to go. And then generally, if you're not of a certain population that gets targeted for harassment, like Arab people or people from Africa, you generally get to go on, right? It's a standard procedure that, at least as an American, it's simple. Every time I go boom, 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 and I'm out. This is a structured interview, right? This guy did not ask me about my day. He didn't ask about my family. He didn't tell me stories about his life. It was a very 5 questions, and then you move on, all right? So this is useful for gathering information that is needed to be gathered in bulk, right? So, survey data, census data, stuff we really need specific information. This is the best kind of interview to do. So if I need to know demographics, like I need to know how many women are in this class, where they're from, their ages, and their major, what's the best way to get this information? Is it to have an unstructured interview where we talk for 30 minutes and I hopefully find this out at some point? Probably not. A semi-structured interview where I ask these questions but give a 5 response to each question? Do you really need to spend 5 minutes telling me your name? No. But perhaps the best way to get this information is just to give you a piece of paper, like you see in a government document, and just have you fill it out and collect it. Right? So, indeed, all 3 methods are useful for different times, different things. So all 3 methods are useful, but they all have their drawbacks. Very important, right? So the strength of the formally structured interview is, 1, you get exactly the information you want. Exactly, right? 2, the information is streamlined in a way it can be used in quantitative methodological research, right? So it's much easier to compile data and create data sets with streamlined information. If I have 500 people to circle 1 to 5 what they think of my class, I can get a lot of information on that. I can do a lot of different number crunching. I can find out the mean, the mode, the standard of error, standard of deviation. There's all kinds of things that I can learn from that kind of question relatively easily. They have statistical programs called STATA and SPSS. You literally plug in these numbers, you press calculate, and it will literally show you all this information. You don't even know you need it. And finally, these are often quick interviews, right? You can get a lot of information really, really quick and relatively cheap. Printing out a piece of paper, making 800 copies, and then handing it to 800 people isn't that expensive. Especially when I have basically free access to the printer here. I don't have to pay for printing. I don't have to pay for paper. The only thing that's costing me is my time. right? And since I'm required to be here 8 hours a day, I'm not losing any time doing my job, right? So this is the kind of research that a lot of social scientists really like to do. And this is why many of us will use structured interviews to gather data. However, you do lack, there are some weaknesses, as you can probably guess. One, there's absolutely no spontaneity, right? You will not learn anything unexpected or useful that you didn't think to ask beforehand. If I give you 10 questions on a piece of paper, you're going to only answer those 10 questions, and that is going to be it. So there's going to be problems with this, right? One, the formality can be alienating to the interviewee. So if I do give you a long survey with questions to fill out, you might not answer truthfully. It's very informal, it's very alienating, and you just might not feel like doing it. This is a very big problem with survey data, knowing whether or not the people are actually giving the true answers or whether they're taking it serious. You know, if I ask what are your attitudes on religion, that's a complicated question. It requires some thinking generally. If you give a 1 second, if you think about for 5 seconds and write a 2 sentence answer, that might not really be what you think, right? Yes?
But if you have a large enough sample, you don't need to worry about if a few people didn't answer correctly.
That's true, yeah. The larger your sample is, it does do a better job of fitting within that margin of error. But once again, that requires more effort and more money than a lot of researchers have. You know, conducting an interview with 5,000 people is a serious task. And generally, and there's all kinds of things that can go wrong in that process. It's called standard error, right?
Yeah.
So there's all kinds of mistakes that happen, even if you don't know it. Sometimes you lose surveys, sometimes surveys get miscalculated. This happens all the time. When you're calculating 10,000 pieces of information, there's a good chance you might actually miscalculate something. Big problem, right? And finally, if the structured questions do not actually answer the questions that you desire, and the questions then are not valid, the entire project is a failure. Here's an example. I've heard stories about this too. What if you wanted to find out the attitude towards Miranda soda amongst all the male population at, if you want to compare male and female's attitudes towards Miranda soda at IUS? And you give a long survey asking, what do you think of Miranda? Do you like orange soda? What would you prefer? Blah, blah, blah. What happens if you forget to ask that fundamental question, male or female? This has happened. I do know of stories where people have done these kinds of studies and the most basic question, male or female, they forget to ask, uh-oh, what does that mean? You have all this information, but you don't know who's who, so you can't sort it. You just wasted a lot of time and energy. And since these surveys are almost always random and anonymous, you can't be like, oh wait, circle male or female. You don't know who it was. So all it takes is one missed question, one misworded question, and you completely destroy your whole research is wasted. And it does happen, you'd be surprised, right? So another type of methodology used in sociology is what's called participant observation, right? So the way this works is the researcher will make efforts to gain close and intimate familiarity with a group of individuals in their practices via intensive involvement with people in their own cultural environment, usually over an extended period of time, right? I give the Turkey example. If Joe Kaminsky wants to learn about this mysterious place called Turkey, then he goes to Turkey and watches these Turks do things such as eat, practice religion, watch Galatasaray football, etc. So I guess.
But the big problem with participant observation is that it's biased.
We'll get to that in a minute. Exactly. You're exactly right. So we see here the way this works, though, is I will ingratiate myself into society. So I will show up in Turkey, and I will observe people. Often I won't let them know. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. So perhaps I'll get a hostel in Istanbul for a couple months, maybe even longer, and I'll just walk around town and hang out at the cafes and just try to blend in, right? Because if I walk around wearing an American cowboy hat and a big shirt that says USA rules, ripped blue jeans, you people are going to probably act different around me. You're going to not be yourselves. You're going to be like, ooh. Right? So you try to fit in. Try to look the part. And this may sound like not that big a deal, right? Because in Turkey, people dress relatively similar to the United States, right? You guys look relatively what I look like. But what about when you go to Borneo and the people are naked? You have a decision you have to make, don't you? You either get naked too and get that rapport and trust with the people you're studying, or you'd be the white guy wearing his clothes and people think, oh, that's the interview guy, be careful, right? And indeed, a lot of researchers will do that. There have been many examples of well-known PhD-holding professors that will go into Borneo or Sub-Saharan Africa and they will be naked for a couple months. There's even one example of an anthropologist who studied the tribe of cannibals in the island of Java, and he actually ate humans too. He actually tasted human flesh. And he said it was very important for him to do that, because once he did, the people totally started acting normal around him. Once he proved that he was cool, then he was in. And he gathered a lot of information. But the real turning point was when he proved that he was serious and delicious, right? So participant observation can be much more difficult in other places, right? It's easy to fit in some societies, in other societies you really stick out, right? So one of the strengths of the participant observation is one definitely gets intimate understanding of the culture they observe in. Generally you spend a long time. So you don't just go to Turkey for a week and check out a cafe and go home. That's not how you do long-term participant observation. Second strength is generally you don't have to worry about the Hawthorne effect as much if you're doing long-term research. Since one, often the people don't know they're being observed, and two, even if they do know they're being observed, people's true colors, as we say, come out after a while, right? So think of it this way. You hang out with somebody once, they can put on an act. I could pretend to be the most romantic, sweetest gentleman in the world, right? For a night or two. If you're with me for 4 or 5 weeks, you're going to see that I like to lay on the couch in my socks and underpants and eat ice cream and watch football and sometimes yell at the TV and play video games like a 10-year-old. And, oh, come on! Oh, that's not fair! And you're going to think, wow, this guy's really annoying. So you can only hide your true colors for so long. So the point here is that when observing different people over a long period of time, they can only put on the act for so long before they can't do it anymore. All right? You all know exactly what I'm talking about. Go visit that grandparent you see once every 5 years who lives on the other side of the world. Yeah, you're gonna be a much, oh, hi grandpa, right? You can do that for 1 or 2 nights, but you can't do it every night. And finally, under this kind of research methodology, large amounts of data could be piled in a relatively short time. So you can get a lot of information pretty quickly by observing people, if you do it right. If you know what you're looking for. But you have to know what you're looking for, that's a problem. You really need to do research beforehand. If I want to study like religious traditions in Turkey, but I went to an area that was completely secular, or if I want to study Christianity in Turkey, but I went to an area that was 100% Muslim because I didn't do my research, I'm really in trouble, aren't I? My point is you need to find out where they are before you make your trip, because if you don't, you're going to be in the wrong place and you're not going to be able to get information again. I have a friend who studied AIDS in India, and she had everything set up great, except for one problem was the place she went to, nobody had AIDS. The town she was in was like a very wealthy, predominantly upper class Brahmin town. Nobody had AIDS, so she had to get on a bus and go hours and hours into the rural where she found these people. And if she would have planned her research better, she would have gone there in the first place, not wasted 3 or 4 days of her 2-week trip trying just to get from point A to point B. Because as you know, transportation in India isn't exactly like it is in France or Germany, right? Okay, what are the weaknesses of this kind of research? Well, one, the money issue, right? Going far away is often expensive, time consuming, possibly even dangerous. My friend, KDK Hill Rincon, going to India as a female, white female from America, there's a lot of risks in that. I'm sure you're all familiar with some of the horrible incidents of gang rape that have happened in India recently. I mean, these are some dangers you have to consider. Right? You really need to be prepared for this. And other things, if you go to a place where you might, there's a lot of places you have to pay somebody a few bucks to get out of trouble. I have friends, I've watched a lot of shows about people, about interviews going in parts of West Africa. And sometimes you gotta pay off officials if you wanna get the information you want, talk to the right people. $100 doesn't hurt sometimes. So perhaps you, you know, it's expensive. You can give one or two guys $100, but if you give everybody $100, you don't have money. So you do, money can be an issue. And two, you can often easily lose track of what you're supposed to do. So the example I give, what if Joe goes to study Islam in Turkey, and I really find some beautiful girl and fall in love and get married and have babies? Well, what happens to my research project? Well, if it even gets done, which it probably won't, because I'm now happily an apricot farmer, it's probably going to be very biased. Yes, I meet the girl of my dreams and have a family, and I'll probably say all kinds of great things about Turkey, even if they're not necessarily true. So you have to be able to draw the line between research and personal. So it's tough. You need to be able to interact with the people. You need to be friendly with them. But you can't become so friendly that you forget that you are still a scientist. And it's your job to give accurate depictions of the world you see. Right? But that's very subjective. That is not a, there is no objective way to explain how to do that. You just have to, in your head, know what is acceptable and what isn't. All right? So finally, I'd like to talk about longitudinal studies, and this is the last thing we're going to talk about in this section. And this is a research study that involves a lot, repeated observations of the same variable, right, over long periods of time, often many years and even decades, right? So longitudinal studies follow the same individuals for a long period of time. So here's an example of one. I think we might be doing one here at IUS, so this might not just be a made-up example. One example would be to follow the progress of IUS graduates over the next 20 years to see if we actually produce students that are successful, right? So the way this would work, if it was done right, is you would take a random sample, right? You wouldn't just take the five highest GPAs and then follow them, because what's the problem with that? If we did a research project where we took the five highest GPAs at the university and followed it for 20 years, what's the problem? Yes.
It's not representative. You won't,
yes.
Yeah, you won't know what happened with the other students that
you have. Exactly. It is not a representative. First off, too small a sample size. And second, it's not representative. Yes, of course the five highest GPAs are probably going to be lawyers and doctors. Doesn't mean everybody is. Probably doesn't mean it at all. So you would need a random sample, and what you do is you follow these people over a long period of time. What's the strength of this? Well, the obvious strength is you can draw some very solid conclusions, airtight theories, when you observe the same person or group of people over 10, 20, and even 30 years. So if I followed the progress of this class over 30 years, I can really find out if you learned sociology or not. I can find out if this class is useful. If 95% of you end up working in a factory, using a hammer pounding nails into something, then maybe my class didn't help you. But if, 20-30% of the class end up as politicians or some type of diplomat, then yeah, this is a, maybe my class did help. But it takes time, right? Because you're still in college. So, the apple tree doesn't blossom overnight. Right? It took me 10 years of schooling to get back, 14 years of schooling to get to where I'm at. Right? I didn't just become a professor magically. It took a long time. So, indeed, a lot of you will graduate and you're not going to be in your perfect job to start, but it takes time, and hopefully by the time you're 25 or 30, you might be doing something you really like and you're making a lot of money, right? So, these observations take time, and there's some serious drawbacks to these longitudinal studies, right? One, these are quite expensive, right? If I want to study and follow you for 30 years, I'm going to have a lot of money. I'm going to have to spend a lot of money on postage, phone calls, right? International phone calls aren't cheap. I'm calling Ghana, and I'm calling China, and I'm calling Norway. It's going to be some bills to be paid.
You should use wireless.
Yet to get
thank you. Yes, I can use wireless, and I can use Skype. But what if the person doesn't have Skype? Not everybody has Skype. But you're right, that is a good point. It is getting easier to do long-term research, because we have more methodological advances. But still, you gotta understand that stuff filters in slowly. Right? It doesn't all happen magically overnight. So, second problem is the time issue. As you know, a longitudinal study means over a long period of time. These studies often go on so long that indeed researchers often retire or die. And there have been many examples of longitudinal studies where a professor 10 years later is retiring and nobody else wants to continue it. The study's over. It's a complete waste of resources. It does sadly happen. And finally, sometimes over such a long period of time, interest in a particular topic has changed so much that the information is no longer even relevant to study. And I got two good examples here. One, what if you wanted to do a longitudinal study beginning in 1986 on people's use of VHS video cassette tapes by people living in Tuzla over a 30-year period? So you want to study how people use VHS tapes starting in 1986 until 2016. What's the problem with this research? Yeah, we have VHS tapes.
Yes.
We do, but they're pretty much impossible. They don't make them. I mean, you don't get video. When a movie comes out, it doesn't come out on VHS. It comes out on Blu-ray, or it gets pirated and is on the internet before it even knows. Right? So indeed, if I were to do a longitudinal study of this, by about 1999, it would have been pretty much outdated. It would have been no longer useful.
Because you have a war.
Right? This is a serious problem. Second one, what if we wanted to measure the attitudes of the Croatian population of Yugoslavia towards the political leadership of the SKJ, and you want to do a study where it went from 1980 to 2015. What's the problem? Yes. There is no such animal as Yugoslavia, and the SKJ is basically nothing today, right? There is no SKJ. There's a Communist Party, and I saw them outside my apartment. There's about 10 of them, and they were wearing their red and acting traditional, but there's 10 of them. So indeed, this project wouldn't even work, right? My parameters have shifted. The SKJ is no longer the only political party. Not only is it not the only political party, it really isn't even a serious competitor anymore. So this project would have been completely outdated by 1991, right? So we see here that when you do longitudinal studies, sometimes what you're studying becomes irrelevant or just doesn't exist anymore. So you have to be very careful. Because, once again, these kinds of studies often involve large institutional grants, and nothing worse than when somebody gives you $100,000 and then 10 years later you say, yeah, I got it. Right? That's bad. This is why longitudinal studies are generally not as common, I would say. Long-term, longitudinal studies. Okay, well, you've now ended chapter 2. So we all know what that means, correct? Yes. Indeed, homework, definitions, all. The end of the chapter, are due next Friday. So just like you did this week, you will turn in your definition. How long approximately did it take you to finish this assignment?
Half an hour.
Half an hour, okay, good.
5 minutes.
Somebody in the other class said 10 minutes. All right, you're free to go. I will see you all on Monday when we begin chapter 3.